Universal Divide and Define Electoral Law. Some of these bribe legal assets of the Nigeria police are here situated in our ministry. Unfortunately, in spite of this organizational advantage, we have over the years been underutilizing the capacity of our lawyers. The time has now come for us to alter this narrative. This is more so that the new orientation and vision for the police under our leadership is that which is driven by respect for rule of law and professional proficiency in the investigative and prosecution functions of the Nigerian police. The achievement of this requires that the legal department of the Nigerian police be reorganized to focus and empower to effectively lead the process. It is in cognizance of this that this meeting was convened. The Commissioner of Police in charge of the legal department has been briefing me constantly on the state of affairs with the department and have taken due cognizance of all the challenges and plans he has highlighted in his opening remarks. I can assure that the legal department will henceforth be prioritized in our leadership scheme and the welfare of lawyers in the Nigerian police as well. The idea is to have a police force that embodies the values of fairness, justice, and equity. This is informed by the reality that policing activities in a democratic society requires accountability, which is indeed demanded for by an increasingly enlightened and diverse citizen. In this regard, it remains the responsibility of the police lawyers to guide investigators in the gathering, preservation, and presentation of evidence, as well as ensure respect for the rights of persons who become the subject of police preventive and investigative procedures, be they suspects or witnesses of crime. The inability of police lawyers to effectively adopt this strategic role in the policing space has immensely contributed to the high rate of failure of investigations and prosecution of cases. This engages my vision for the police. The situation in the civil justice sector presents another daunting challenge, as civil actions against the police are either not dependent or poorly dependent, resulting in the award of damages and eventual garnishing of police accounts. As confirmed by the Commissioner of Police Gega, as of today, the amount of garnishing against the police stands at about 1,642,008,603 naira. Much as actions have been taken to address the issues and align civil actions and award against the police, there is the need to strengthen our legal department both in terms of structure, manpower, and processes to position them in addressing this major challenge. Indeed, if this situation is not urgently addressed, the police may not be able to perform its function as the limited budgetary allocations will be needlessly lost to garnishing actions. Given the institutional challenges, the police as a key player in the criminal justice sector faces in integrating the capacity of police lawyers by creating a unique platform where they can network and deepen their knowledge and skills has also become imperative, especially in the light of the passage of Administration of Criminal Justice Act 2015. In due appreciation of these realities, my plan is to be invigorated and in place a legal section that ensures a pride of place for police lawyers, a legal section that is the envy of every police lawyer, and a legal section where police lawyers are eager and desirous to work. I therefore urge you to make the best of this opportunity by actively supporting us in attending our plans and demonstrate the determination to act as change agents that will alter the professional function of the Nigerian Police Legal Section. It is on this note that I welcome you all to this landmark engagement, and I wish you all rewarding deliberations. I thank you and pray for Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance from you all as we jointly march towards a moment of police force that will be driven by rule of law, tenets, and motivated to excel in its criminal justice delivery. Thank you for coming.
With a view to addressing the numerous legal challenges faced by the force, such as the defense of civil suits against the force, the legal legal advice of investigated by the force, prosecution of cases, drafting of legal documents, legal representation of the force, among others. There is no doubt, sir, that the legal section over the years has played a fundamental role in servicing the seven directorates of the force throughout the country and providing legal services to the force. The responsibilities of the section, therefore, entails enormous commitment of its personnel. The legal section of the Nigerian Police Force from inception in 1980 has been a section in the force criminal investigation department and at the state CIDs all over the country, usually headed by the Commissioner of Police and other officers manning the sections in the commands. The first Commissioner of Police that was posted to the legal section was C.P. Joseph Iyamago from 1980 to 1982, just for the records. Since then, several other Commissioners of Police have been posted. Currently, I stand humbly before you as a current CP leader. Thank you. Sir, the mission of establishing the legal section, as earlier stated, is to render efficient legal services to the Nigeria Police Force. In achieving this mission, the following goals have been set for attainment. One, to provide sound legal representation for the force in all courts, to render sound legal advice in all cases referred to the section, to make sound legal inputs in all bills referred to the IGP from National Assembly and the Presidency, to ensure effective representation of the force at public hearings, at National Assembly and other engagements, to provide legal assistance to all investigative bodies of the force, to ensure all agreements between the force and other organizations are drafted, to ensure that the force is adequately protected, to provide effective representation of the force both at national and international committees as required by the force, to ensure that all personnel of the legal sector are adequately trained. In striving to achieve this, the above goals, the sector has been faced with some enormous challenges, some which I identified as listed below. Manpower needs. It is imperative to state, sir, that the Nigerian Police Force as an organization has the highest number of lawyers in any organization, as you can see from the array of lawyers seated here, sir. To achieve optimal performance, the sector requires adequate manpower. However, this is not the case, as the present strength of the personnel of the section nationwide is inadequate. This is due to mostly the unwillingness of some of our police lawyers to serve in the legal section, as well as the retirement of several personnel of the legal section throughout the country on an annual basis. As of this, the section has a staff strength of only 275 police lawyers in all the legal sections nationwide, and this we consider as inadequate. Current at the first CID, first headquarters level, currently is also grossly understaffed. A situation where only 33 lawyers are handling all the cases and legal issues of all the departments of the force at the force headquarters level is considered quite overwhelming and reduces the effectiveness and efficiency of the lawyers. The lawyers in the legal department are obviously overstretched. To address the problem of manpower need of the section in the future, it is recommended so that police lawyers who pass out from the police academy be posted to the legal section after their 1 year probational period and to remain in the section for a period of at least 5 years before being transferred to other general duties. It is also recommended, sir, that the IGP gives his approval for the legal section to draw additional personnel, lawyers, from those already in service to enhance the performance of the section. As you can see here, sir, we have quite a large number of police men who are lawyers, but I believe only a fraction of them are currently serving in the legal section. And this we want to request that the IG gives us the go ahead to increase the strength of legal sections. Another challenge that we observe in the legal section is that of motivation. It is not a doubt that promotion is one of the greatest mechanisms used to encourage performance. Motivation of personnel of the section in terms of special promotion for outstanding performance or commendation for exceptional performance by the IGP will go a long way in enhancing output of lawyers in the section. This is because defense of suits against the force and prosecution of cases entail a lot of sacrifice on the part of the lawyers of the section, who are usually confronted by very senior members of the bar, mostly senior advocates, in the course of defense and prosecution of cases. And sometimes exigencies require these lawyers traveling to different states and putting a lot of pressure on them. It's also recommended, sir, that personnel of the section who perform exceptionally well be considered for special promotion as well as other motivational awards. The IGP may also wish to know that the memo on this subject of promotion had earlier been submitted to his office for consideration, recommending that a policy be put in place similar to that which exists and which affects other departments of the force, such as the medical section where doctors are given. We equally have the challenge of logistics. For a lawyer to effectively function, the issue of logistics needs to be properly addressed. There's a need for vehicles specifically to be provided to the section for ease of movement to and from court to convey lawyers, so that can mitigate the expenses lawyers bear in attending cases in court. This is closely tied to that of funding, as successive legal service the world over is financially demanding. The police legal section requires adequate funding. In addition to administrative costs, funds are required for late filing, arising from late delivery of court processes to legal section, payment of bailiffs of court to serve court processes filed by police lawyers, funds to prosecute appeals, especially transmitting records of appeal and which arise from decisions of courts against the police, and which also subsequently results in garnishing of police accounts and summary expenses. Adequate funding of the legal sector is necessary to guarantee a successful operation. The Inspector General of Police may wish to know that on the issue of transmission of records, we have had some challenges, specifically touching on some of very sensitive garnishing cases. As we stand presently, we have four cases which are currently ongoing in Lagos, and which put a burden of about $2 billion on the Nigerian police force. And we're trying our best to ensure that we are able to set aside such proceedings against the police. The lack of good legal officers in the command has also hindered effective legal services. For example, we observe that in most commands, lawyers do not have office space to settle down and do their legal work. And this has negatively impacted the ability to focus, thereby leading to low performance instead of the optimal performance. The provision of good accommodation definitely will improve the performance of lawyers in commands and formations across the country. There's also the lack of an up-to-date reference library at the commands level. Effective legal services require an up-to-date reference library to equip lawyers with current authorities in cases that they are handling. This is lacking in the force, as only the legal office at the force headquarters has a library and which does not even provide electronic services for research. While in the commands and formations across the country, law libraries do not exist, making police lawyers rely on their own lean resources compared to their colleagues in private practice. There is also the need for continuing legal education. The continuing legal training is a key to greater performance. There is a need for police lawyers to have opportunity to enhance legal education, to acquire higher degrees in law from local and international universities, and other organized legal training institutions to update the lawyers in the legal sector throughout the federation. Some of these lawyers can even serve as lecturers at the Faculty of Law of the Nigerian Police Academy, and please inform the IDP, sir, that as it stands with the lawyers that have documented today, we have about 22 of them that have master's degrees in law. Effort is therefore required in realizing this much needed capacity building for lawyers of this section. On the issue of judgment against the force, I was talking about Kanishi cases arising from poorly and protracted investigation, illegal detention of suspects, human rights violations, police involvement in civil matters, and poor funding of prosecution and defense of cases, etc. This has given rise to civil litigations and subsequent garnishee of police accounts. As of December 2018, the amount of garnishee stood at 1.6 billion naira. Principally concerned about this development, the section has worked out strategies like establishment of garnishee desk officers at the command and at the legal office at the force headquarters here to enable them to handle the matters and mitigate the serious challenges. There's equally the challenge we observe arising from the enactment of the Tribunal Criminal Justice Act. Recently, we have been reading of cases where the police have been said to have been excluded from prosecution at the magistrate courts. This problem arose from the principal act at the federal level, which excluded police lay prosecutors from going to prosecute. And as we stand, we lost close to 3,800 cases that were already in court, which we were asked to submit the cases at the case files to the DPP, the Minister of Justice. And we observed that even the Minister of Justice does not have the capacity to carry out with those cases. And the fallout from that is that when such cases are struck out, the accused persons usually go to court to seek redress against the police. We have an instant case where the police, where judgment have been given against the police for 91 million based on such abandonment of one of those cases by the Ministry of Justice. Point out that the Ministry of Criminal Justice Act 2015 in section 15 and 17 makes it mandatory for statements recorded for suspects to be in writing and video recorded electronically. The Act makes it compulsory for interrogation rooms to be set up in all police stations throughout the country. This ensures that statements recorded from suspects are admitted in evidence without necessity for trial within trial. This provision has been given judicial interpretation by the Court of Appeal in a plethora of cases. The setting up of interrogation rooms in all police stations throughout the country no doubt entails enormous budgetary allocation, requiring the approval of the National Assembly. While this is likely to be a long-term issue, the courts can look inwards for possible solution. I believe that the first criminal investigation department has taken steps to make provision for this at the headquarters level. And I wish to implore the IG to consider emphasizing this in the command so that when lawyers go to court, the issues of trial within trial will be eliminated. In order to achieve the vision of the section, it is pertinent to place the following sir. Adopting concerted efforts to make the legal sections in the command more vibrant, such as organizing national workshops on police, the rule of law, and fundamental rights in democracy, with sub-teams on the provisions of the ACJA as it affects arrest, remand and bail proceedings, human rights, public order, garnishing, etc. Sir, earlier mentioned here that illegal detention of suspects, violation of suspects' human rights, involvement in civil matters and poor funding are among the main issues that have given rise to judgments against the police. We observe that most of these infractions come from investigating units at both the command and the headquarters level and all the special investigating outfits. We know that the provisions of the provisions of the law makes it mandatory for investigating officers to follow the rule of law whenever they are investigating their cases. Embarking on the drive to get the commands and relevant sections to ensure greater observance of human rights to maintain the decline in judgments and garnishing orders. Initiating processes to make the command more responsive to the needs of their legal sections. Providing more robust training activities for the personnel of the legal section. Engaging in greater partnership and synergy with relevant stakeholders to provide the needed legal services. Considering the possibility of upgrading the legal section into a full department to make it responsive to the needs of other departments. With respect to this, sir, I have it on record that approval had ever been given to this memo by the former Inspector General of Police, IGP Arase. And we want to request that there might be need for a certification and reconsideration by the force management. I want to at this juncture thank the Inspector General of Police.